Hello and welcome to this Swift tutorial. This episode is about running Swift GUI, the user interface, for the first time, setting it up correctly, and going online for the first time. So let's have a look. You all start, of course, by starting Swift, and I will start the Swift launcher first. Here we go. All right, just to go from top to bottom, latest news, you can see here the blog, okay, then window type. All right, you can start and run the GUI, the game user interface, either in a standard Windows type Windows frame or frameless. I personally prefer frameless, so I select frameless. Core mode, you need this if you happen to be using two computers and you would like to run the Swift core program on another computer to distribute it, but I do not have that, so I keep the standalone version. And check for updates, well, self-explanating, so nothing new. Check again, nothing new, so there's not a new version available from what I have. And start application. Well, we've seen it before. You can start the game user interface from here, the mapping tool, which as well is called Swift Data, or the config wizard. We don't need it anymore. We did it already when we installed Swift. So let's go to the game user interface, the GUI. All right, here we go. So you will see this big area here. On top you see several menus and status lights, but let's start here on the bottom. In this area you have several function keys. We call them widgets. So for example, we have the connect widget. The connect widget shows you everything that is relevant for you to connect to VATSIM or another network. And in case that your GUI window is not tall enough, you will lose the ability to select a server here. So if you just see this, please expand the vertical size, extend the vertical size of your GUI, and then you will get the drop-down list. At the moment we don't use this AFV data. Oh, this model verification message, we're going to talk about it in a moment, how to switch it off if you don't want to have it. So we close it, so we're back to the GUI. And AFV data, that's part of the audio for VATSIM data server. Don't connect to this one, it will not work. Choose any other. I'm German, so I use Germany, but it doesn't matter. With the new VATSIM structure, it does not matter what server you use. They will all be at the same speed and the same ping, the same delay or lack of delay as the other ones. So you can use Sydney, Australia, you can use USA West or Germany or whatever. It doesn't matter. Then on top, next to VATSIM as well, you have a tab called Other Servers. We will talk about this in another tutorial when we talk about Tower View, because you are as well able to use Swift to connect your flight simulator to the radar client Euroscope, and then you'll be able to see all the aircraft on the ground at a given airport in Euroscope. Or rather, what Euroscope sees can be injected into your flight simulator via Swift. But this will be a separate topic, a separate video. All right, let's continue. This is all part of it. Mode, normal or observer. If you happen to fly a shared cockpit, the active pilot, the number one connection, will use normal, and the second pilot will be using observer mode. So the VATSIM controllers will only see one target on their screen, but not two. Then pilot's info is the next part of this. Obviously you have to fill in your VATSIM ID, your VATSIM network password. I'm not going to show it to you here. I just copy and paste it. I fill in my full real name that I have registered with. The home base is either you leave it blank or you have to enter a four-letter ICAO code of an airport that is near your real location or that you would like to show as your home base. I'm living near this place, EDSB, so I'm filling in this. Own aircraft. Here you see model with a green frame. This is what Swift recognized what plane I'm currently using in my simulator. And as well, this is an indication that I have a positive connection between Swift, the GUI, and my simulator. As well, you can see it up here. You see next to sim here the lit up LED or status light that it shows that I have an active connection between the GUI of Swift and my simulator. This one here means network. I'm at the moment we are offline, so we don't have a network connection, so that's fine. Map, yeah, we are connected to the mapper. This is about if it's connected to the mapper your model set, that's fine. And PTT, this light will come on as long as you push the push to talk or PTT button on your joystick or keyboard or whatever you have defined. And audio means as well that your audio is active, that you are fine there. And the symbol here on the far left, this is your transponder status. At the moment S means it's standby. If I click on it, I get C like mode Charlie, so it's active. However, once as well we can as well steer it or control it from within our cockpit in our simulator normally. Let's continue down here. So as I said, here you have the green frame. If you do not have a good connection, then it will look like this. Let me show you a screenshot. There you go. If it's not good, you're gonna see a red frame, and as well you see the light for simulator is off, so you do not have a proper connection or any connection to your simulator. And if it cannot recognize, analyze your aircraft model in your sim, well, you can't connect, obviously. Huh? No connection to a sim, no connection to VATSIM or any network. Right, let's continue. Call sign. In call sign, you fill in either your airline call sign, like DLH for Lufthansa, and then your flight number 1234 or whatever you want to use. Or if you fly a light aircraft or anything else like this, you enter the registration of your flight. Please do not use any minus or dash signs, although these planes will have these minus or dash signs outside on the fuselage. But for ATC and flight plan purposes, you do not use these minuses, these dashes, no. So if you want to be Delta, Echo, Fox, Echo, or Oscar X-ray, you enter this, like this, and not like this. So delete the minus. Then there you go, Cessna 172. This is what has been filled in automatically by Swift because it recognized the type of aircraft I was using in my sim. Shouldn't it be correct, you just manually enter it. It has to be a four-letter code, which is standard with ICAO for the type of aircraft. For example, if you fly the Cebu Mod 737-800, you would enter Boeing 738. And there you go. You have different versions you can choose from, but probably it's going to be the 737-800, this one. Next line you see type. type is not type of aircraft, it's type of plane rather. It's a three-letter code. The first one describes whether it's a land aircraft or a seaplane. So if it was a seaplane, it would be S, like Sierra. The second is the number of engines. So 2, a 737 800 has two engines, so it's a 2. And the third letter is the type of engine. So J, Juliet, stands for jet engine. If it was a prop, it would be P, like Papa. So let's fill in again. If you don't want to fill manually, you can just here reload your type of aircraft to recognize it again from your sim, and Swift will automatically fill in the type of aircraft and as well the type of plane. So you see, land aircraft, one engine, piston. So, and airline, obviously, if you fly an airline aircraft, for example, let's put again the Lufthansa in there. It normally should recognize it automatically. If not, then you fill it in manually, DLH, and select it. And then you are in business. Because what is displayed here, or what you define here in call sign, does not necessarily mean that the plane is painted like a Lufthansa aircraft. Let's say it's a wet lease aircraft. Lufthansa is using, for example, Alitalia aircraft and crew to operate some flights because they have a lack of planes and crew. Then you would still fly on a Lufthansa call sign, but you fill in here the Alitalia livery. So somebody else would see you as Alitalia, Airbus 320, or whatever type of aircraft you're gonna be using. All right? So, but since we are flying a general aviation aircraft, we leave the airline field empty. And basically, that's it. We can connect now. So, let's. Oh, by the way, maybe you should see my aircraft. By magic, my simulator is running already. It's all prepared. Like in that famous cooking show, everything is there, and let's connect. Cool. So now we are connected, and the Swift GUI switched automatically to the cockpit widget. In the cockpit widget, you see different settings up there. You see your comm radio frequencies, that's the active, the standby frequency. You can swap them. For example, if I put in here 118.205, enter, and then you swap it as you need it. But of course, if you are inside your cockpit, when you switch here, it will switch to in your Swift GUI. You got the same here for transponder. You can set it here in your cockpit, like 7000. Oops, 7000. Maybe I should clear it. There we go. So 7000 is set. And when I set the transponder here to altitude on, it as well changes here to mode Charlie. And as well, if I select standby here, it as well jumps here to standby. So in most cockpits, it does work, this connection. There may be some isolated add-on aircraft where it does not work, but well, normally it does. Cell call may be interesting for those of you who fly long haul and cross the Atlantic. You can set up your cell call, and as well, it does verify that you are actually using a valid cell call combination. So, for example, if you do not stick to the rule, it will tell you that you cannot use this code. So, you can't use the same starting letter twice. So, it gives you a red X here. And now it's valid. There's your green check mark. Alright, cool. Then, as where you see the cockpit and the audio widgets, they are almost identical. Eh? You still got the same up here, and here in the bottom part, you got two different tabs: devices and volumes and notifications. You can switch on and off the notification sounds. So maybe the PTT click, PTT is push to talk, will help you identify when you push your PTT on your joystick that you're actually pushing it, so you have some kind of feedback. But you have to get used to it. Very important, yes. You should have the supervisor message on, so you do not miss it. If you want to change the volume of these notifications, you do it here. Or if you want to use your own sounds, you can define your own sound directory where you save them. You just have to use the same file names that Swift is using in its original sound path and directory. Devices and volumes is quite self-explaining here. You can select the device that you want to transmit on, or which microphone you want to use. You can do a voice loopback test. And as you can see here, while I'm speaking, this is the voice in volume bar. If it's green when you talk at a normal tone, a normal volume, you're right. Otherwise, you have to adjust this here up and down. And the same is for out. If it's too loud for you, what you hear from other pilots and controllers, you can adjust it here. So let's continue with some more of these widgets. Another widget that you're probably going to use by standard for flights probably will be the text and chat widget. Up here you see different tabs. COM1 is Radio 1, COM2 is Radio 2, and UNICOM. Obviously, UNICOM is defined here as 122.80. That's why the UNICOM tab does have the same messages that are here on COM2, because our COM2 in our cockpit is tuned here to UNICOM. And if you have all, you see all everybody who's around. But I suggest when you fly, you probably want to have it on COM1 only, otherwise it's too much chat here, because COM1 is what you do on your COM1 radio, and if you leave an active ATC zone, you will anyway select UNICOM there, and there you have it. So what's going on? Here on the bottom, when you activate this message to section, you will see ATC stations that are within your area, your reception area, and by clicking on them, you can start a voice chat to them. For example, if I want to send a message here to this controller, I just click on it, and up here on top, there is a new chat window, a new tab open, and I see the name of the guy, the controller, and his call sign, and I can write here, like, "Hi there, how are you? La 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 la," etc. Of course, we don't do that now here. And if you want to close it, you just click it here. And if you want to save space, you just deactivate it, and then your chat log here is just a bit larger. Settings. Obviously, you can increase the size of the letters, the font. You can change the font and the style, and you can as well select with focus. You can select what message will be displayed in a pop-up window when you are not actually on the text chat widget while somebody is sending a message to you. So this may be useful to you, so I would leave the focus on, but if you select frequency, you will get a pop-up window for any message that is being sent on this channel, on your comm chat, text chat, when you are outside the text chat, for example here. That's a bit annoying, so frequency is not so good, but private, supervisor and cell call is appropriate. And if again, just deactivate it to hide it, and then you have more space again. It's less cluttered. Another widget that you will probably use quite often or regularly maybe is the aircraft widget. On the aircraft widget you see planes that are around in your area that can be or that are displayed in your simulator as multiplayer aircraft, as one from one of your model sets. And let me just expand this window sideways here, so you see all the information. For example, here at the moment it's ordered by standard, by default it's ordered by distance from your position. So there is this plane and this plane, they're both 2 miles at ground level, ground speed 0 knots, so they are parked somewhere here on the airport. So let's have a look. I right click on it, but please, this is only for X-Plane. I think in prepared FSX this does not work, it's only for X-Plane. So I can go follow in simulator, and sure enough there is a plane, and yep, it's a Gulf Air. But here he says it's a Gulf Air 787-900. This looks more like a Boeing 767, but well, it's close enough. If I want to check it out further, what Swift is doing, you can go from the widget of aircraft, you can go to models, and you basically have the same indication extended by what Swift is doing with it. So, for example, we see here Gulf Air 016, and it's showing as a Boeing 767-300, the model, which was what we see, because aircraft defined by the pilot is a 787-900, but I don't have that in my model set, so it's trying to get the closest match to it, which is a Gulf Air livery, but a Boeing 767-300. That's how it works basically, and as well you can see it's using the Bluebell Boeing 767-300 model from my model set. And you can even change that down here, for example you can return there and choose any other 767, or if you want to insist on having a Boeing 787, so you go here, Boeing 788, I think there is no 789 in our set, so 788, and you just choose another one. Let's use Etihad just for fun, and if you then press save, it will take a moment. We jump back to our aircraft and you go again, follow in simulator, and there is an Etihad Boeing 787-800. So you have the rather correct type of aircraft but wrong livery, so you can choose what you prefer if you want to do it manually. This is just to play with and to rematch and go back to your reason. You do this, it will do it after a while. All right, we go back to our cockpit. Then there are some settings that you would probably like to do. Let me get this back to a normal size. Let's go to settings and we go to simulator. Especially for X-Plane, there are some interesting settings. You click on these three dots here to open the next window. And this is all good. There we go. Max distance means the maximum distance within which Swift will actually display aircraft from your position. So 50 miles is the standard. I will not change it, that's fine. Follow aircraft distance. So what we just did with this following aircraft, by default it's set to 200 meters, which is about 3.28 is about 600 something feet. If you think it's too far away, you just change it. Let's put it at 50 meters. Please note, this change will only take effect when you restart your flight simulator. You are explained. The next option is labels, draw labels. Labels is, let me see here. If you go to your X-Plane cockpit and you press the button C like Charlie, you can jump out of your cockpit. And then you see we have lots of aircraft. Well, we have three aircraft, but you can see they have these labels, these call sign labels attached to them. Let's go to here, this Lufthansa, Airbus. And you have two ways to turn them off. Either you do it from within X-Plane, you go to the plugins menu and you go to X-Swift bus, and then you can select show hide aircraft labels. Now it's gone. The only issue is, now this guy disappeared, he logged off. What a pity. Let's try again our friend over here from the Gulf, which is still Etihad. So now the label is gone. There's only one issue. If you do it from within X-Plane, this setting show or hide will only be valid until the end, until you shut down X-Plane. When you start X-Plane again, it will have forgotten the setting. However, when you change, or if you change the setting here inside the GUI, this will be a permanent change. So I personally prefer having no labels, so I will leave the check mark off and I go OK to save it. The final saving of this setting will be done when you shut down Swift GUI. It will ask you, you want to change, save these setting changes. Alright, so we're back here on the simulator page of settings. There are some interesting options. You can sync the time to your real time or whatever you do and then apply it. ComSync, this is quite interesting. If you think, let's jump back to our cockpit. So you see up here you have all these COM settings. Because now with the new audio for VATSIM, you actually have to do something with it. So it's actually recognizing which microphone of which radio, because you have COM radio 1 and COM radio 2 you're using. And in case that you can't transmit properly or it does not switch, if you select this COM sync on and then apply, it will use what you are doing here on this panel. Let's have a look. If I go back to the audio widget and I go to devices and volumes, you see here, there we have transmit on radio 1, transmit, sorry, receive on radio 1, transmit on radio 2 and receive number 2. So at the moment I'm only receiving on COM 2 like this, but I'm transmitting and receiving on number 1. If I go here to COM2, you see it's jumping over to transmit and receive to, but nothing on number one. Let's go back there and we're in business. So in the Cessna, the small button is the audio out, so what you are receiving on your headset or speakers, and MIC stands for microphone when you want to talk. So that does work. And you don't get that unless you change your similar settings to use COMSync. If you have it off, you will always transmit and receive automatically on your radio number one, period. This here is all good. I have not played with it yet, so I think we can ignore it. It's all good. Yeah, this is most of it. Another gadget that is quite nice is here, radar. As you can see, you can zoom in and out. I'm doing it with the scroll wheel of my mouse, but as well you can use this drop-down menu to change the radio, the radius, the range of your radar, and you can, at the moment, here this is heading up, or you go to lock north to have it in the north. Now, some cool things. All of these windows or of these widgets as well, you can take them out of the GUI and you can have them as a standalone window. So what you do is just you right click, of course here on the text chat, doing it here doesn't help, you have to go somewhere outside the text area, and then if you click on the right mouse button you get this context window. Or menu rather. If you go to float, suddenly you see our text chat widget is now a floating window with this, of course here with this window bar on top. It's not very pretty, but as well if you again go here to the area like this for example and you right click, you can make it go frameless and now it's prettier. Now, even better, if you again go to the context menu and you go always on top, it will now disappear. That's a problem with the Windows OS. But don't worry, it's not gone. Yeah, it's not here. But if you again click on text chat, it's here. And now it's on top. You see, when I select explain, it's still staying on top. So that's all cool. So this may be useful to you if you want to hide Swift GUI in the background, but you would like to keep watching your text chat here somewhere in your cockpit or on a second screen, as you prefer. And if you want to bring it back and you're on the frameless version, you just again right click and you go to dock and it's back in here. And you can do this with all the other widgets, for example radar, here, float, always on top, again radar and frameless, and there you go. Okay, change size, and then you have a nice radar wherever you want to put it, up to you. And we dock it again. Alright, that's it basically. This is your first connection to VATSIM and your basic setups. Let me check my list that I haven't forgotten anything. I think that's it basically, yeah. Oh yeah, we can have a look how you as well can send a private chat message to somebody who is not listed here. Because maybe you see another pilot who you want to talk to. So go to the aircraft list and then, for example, you want to ask this Gulf Air guy, what type of aircraft are you really flying or what add-on are you flying? So again, mark it, right mouse button, COM and show text message. And there you go. You have a text tab with this pilot and you can type down here, blah, 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 hello, how are you? Or you close it when you are done. Or if you made a mistake. And if you want to chat with somebody who's not within your range, you just go here, and if you keep your mouse cursor on top of the text entry line or box, you get this context menu and you can see all the text commands that are available. For example, we can say .mgfa016 and then your text la la la. If I now pressed enter, it would open as well a new text chat tab or window up there, and I would send this message directly to this pilot. I'm not doing it now because I do not want to annoy him. He's busy. Yeah, I think that's it basically. Oh yeah, I missed the flight plan, I just see. Flight plan is here. Let's extend the size, so we have it all here. As you can see, there are lots of things that you can enter. But I will make a separate tutorial how to fill in a flight plan correctly. And so please wait for that. It's easier, because it will take a few more minutes. Alright then, I hope this was useful to you, and see you or hear you in the next tutorial.